Welcome back, students. So we shall continue with our lecture. In previous session, we have seen different types of microprocessor, history and how each processor has evolved over the time. Starting from 4004 to 8486, we saw all the variants and how they are different from each other. So let's continue now. In this session, we are going to learn different classifications of different types of microprocessors and a block overview of microprocessor. This is a second part in your first chapter introduction. So students, as we have learned in our session, there are different types, different varieties of microprocessors. And these microprocessors, they are basically categorized or classified based on various criteria. So mainly there are three criteria based on which our microprocessors have been classified. So the first criteria is the based on the size of the data. So microprocessors are classified based on how much data, how much size of data that microprocessor can handle. In previous session, we have seen 4-bit microprocessor, 8-bit microprocessor, 16-bit, 32-bit, 64-bit. So this is how they are classified based on the amount of data that it can handle. That is 4-bit microprocessors, 8, 16, 32 and 64. Second classification is based on the application of the processor, where it is used. So in previous session, we have learned there are two different types of processors generally, which is general purpose microprocessor and special purpose microprocessor. So general purpose microprocessor, it is used for any application. Basically, it can be programmed, it can be modified accordingly to the task. Special purpose microprocessors, they are designed to specifically handle special functions which are required for an application. Okay, like your digital signal processor, then your application specific IC, these are special purpose processors. Now, there is another classification in this criteria, which is microcontroller. So microcontrollers are basically microprocessor chips, which has built-in hardware for memory or ports. Usually our general microprocessor, they don't have built-in hardware for your buses, for your ports and so on. So microcontroller is another criteria, which has another classification in the criteria, which is basically a microprocessor which has built-in hardware for memory and ports on the chip itself. So these are the three types of microprocessor which is based on the criteria of application of the processor. That is general purpose processor, special purpose processor and your microcontroller. Now, third criteria is based on the architecture and the hardware of the processor. So there are different types of processors like RISC processor, CISC processor, VLIW processors, superscalar processors. First one, that is a RISC processor. It is reduced instruction set processor because it supports limited machine language instructions. And since it has limited number of instructions, it can execute programs faster. Second classification in these criteria is CISC processor, which is complex instruction set processor. It has more instructions as compared to RISC, but it is slightly complex, slow and expensive as compared to your RISC processor. Next classification in this category criteria is VLIW processor, which is very long instruction word processors. So these processors, they have instructions which are composed of many machines operations. So now since instruction is complex, long, composed of multiple operations at an instance. It can perform certain functions in parallel. And since it can perform functions in parallel, it increases the efficiency of the processor. The operations can be performed faster with less resources and less time. So this is the use of VLIW processor, which is very long instruction word processor. How the name stands? Because it is basically a composition of multiple operations combined together as a very long instruction. And last is a superscalar processor in this particular criteria. So in VLIW, basically we perform modifications in software, that is program. We perform modification in instruction in order to achieve parallelism, that is to increase the efficiency. But in superscalar processor, we use hardware to achieve parallelism. So hardwares in your system, they are connected in such manner that they can perform multiple functions, multiple operations in parallel. And that is how we can increase the speed of execution. Alright students, so these are the three classifications of microprocessor. So first is based on size of the data, which is how we can classify microprocessors into 4-bit, 8-bit, 16, 32 and 64-bit. Next is based on the application of the processor, and that is how we can divide it into general purpose, which can perform any function. Microcontroller, which is basically everything on a single chip, that is even memory and ports. And third is a special purpose, which targets only specific function. And for last criteria, that is based on architecture and hardware, we have RISC, CISC, VLIW and superscalar. RISC is a system which has reduced instruction set, but it is easier to program, code, execute. CISC, it has a complex instruction set, but in return, it has increased efficiency, speed. Next one is VLIW, which is very long instruction word processor, in which all the multiple operations are composed as a single long instruction to achieve the parallelism. And last one is a superscalar processor, in which we assign the hardware, we arrange the hardware in such manner that we can perform various functions together, that is simultaneously. So these are the three classification criteria based on which microprocessors are classified. Next student, we learn functional block overview of microprocessor. So in this section, basically, we will dwell upon each functional unit which is there present in your microprocessor chip. So as you can see on your screen, there are four basic units of microprocessor, which is ALU, register, control unit and instruction register and decoder. So we will see and learn, and we'll see the functioning of each unit in detail. As we have learned already, the job of microprocessor, the basic function of most microprocessor is to take an instruction from a user and perform the function based on that instruction. Now we will see how each of these functional units facilitate this process of executing an instruction or performing certain function in your microprocessor. So these are basically the primary functions of each unit. First one, we will go through ALU. So ALU stands for Arithmetic and Logical Unit. This unit is nothing but the computational unit of the microprocessor. Arithmetic and logical unit, as you all know already, it is used to perform functions and operations such as arithmetic functions or mathematical functions like addition, subtraction and etc. And also it can perform logical functions like your AND, XOR, and so on. So ALU is like a hub which is a computational unit. That means the hub which actually calculates or which actually performs the function. Second is the register array. So second block over here, it is nothing but the array of registers. Array of memory chunks. Register is nothing but a chunk of memory. And these registers are used to store the data, which is a temporary data. Now, when you are executing a particular code, it creates temporary variables, right? Or a user gives an instruction to the system to create temporary variable to store certain amount of data. So these registers are nothing but the chunks which stores this variable data. So registers are the unit which are used to store temporary data which are accessed using instructions. The next important unit in your microprocessor is your control unit. So control unit, as the name suggests, it performs the necessary control over your system of operation. It provides the timing and the control system, like your error function, your flag system, and so on. So these functionalities are handled by the control unit, that is to check the system of operation whether it is working properly or not. And the last unit is instruction register and instruction decoder. So whenever the instruction is fetched from the memory, first user gives the instruction, right? Instruction is stored in the memory, and then microprocessor fetches this instruction from the memory, executes it, and returns the output to the memory. So whenever this instruction is fetched from the memory, it is first loaded in the instruction register. All right? So instruction register is used to store the loaded instruction from the memory. An instruction decoder is nothing but an execution unit which executes this instruction which is fetched from the memory. So this forms your fourth and the last functional unit in microprocessor, which is instruction register and decoder. That is nothing but your loader and executor. Instruction register loads the instruction or fetches the instruction from the memory, and decoder actually executes that instruction. That means it compiles and interprets that instruction. So these are the four basic blocks of microprocessor that you need to remember and the functionality of each block. In next topic, student, that is merits of microprocessor, we will see why our IT industry is more inclined towards using microprocessor systems. So I have listed some few and primary advantages of the microprocessor, which is why it is highly in use. So first and the foremost importance of microprocessor is the small size of the microprocessor. As we have compared different systems, different processor from mechanical age, electrical age, electromechanical age, you can compare the size of our previous processor and microprocessor. Since it has a small size, like the tiniest sort of like a chip, basically the developer can carry it anywhere. It is portable, and secondly, it can be incorporated or embedded into any hardware. And thus, it gave rise or birth to an area known as embedded system. Next advantage or merit of microprocessor is its low power consumption. Now, since it is built on a singular chip, it tends to consume the lesser power as compared to the one which are used in electrical or mechanical age. The third advantage is its low cost. Now, as you compare your previous processors and microprocessor, you can see there is much low cost involved in making microprocessors and also managing microprocessor. As we compared the processors earlier, they used something known as vacuum tubes, lots of wires to give inputs, to calculate, to provide output. And all these are eliminated in microprocessor. And that is why it reduces the overall cost, which is a built and management cost of microprocessor. Next important factor of microprocessor is the speed of operation. Microprocessor works on 4-bit, 8-bit, 16-bit, 32, and also now on 64-bit word length. And thus, it has increased the speed of operation, how it can execute and calculate some function. And last is the processing capability. We have covered earlier the different variations and how it varies from the data and the bit that are used in the processing of the microprocessor. So it provides high efficiency and high processing capability in order to perform different types of functions like your arithmetic function and your logical function. So these are the main rudimentary advantages of microprocessor for which they are extensively used in these days. Alright, so now that we have seen the overall block view of microprocessor and advantages of microprocessor, we'll see the place of microprocessor in your microcomputer. That is, we will see how your microprocessor works in conformation with the microcomputer in order to establish the entire system, which is your personal computer. So as you can see on the screen, this is how the internal circuitry of the microcomputer looks like. So there is a microprocessor over here. It has the components, which is ALU, registers, control unit, and also control unit here adds up the instruction registers and decoders. And this microprocessor is connected with the other system or other parts of microcomputer using an interface, which is a system bus. Now we will see each of these components in detail in order to find out what is the functionality of this component and how it works all together. So the first component, the primary component of your microcomputer, is the brain of the microcomputer. And over here, microprocessor forms the brain of the microcomputer, which is the CPU, that is central processing unit. So the job of the CPU is to accept the inputs from input devices like your USB, your mouse, keyboard, and so on. And depending on the instruction, it performs the operation using memory and finally outputs the result using your output devices. So this is the job of your central processing unit. And over here in the system of microcomputer, microprocessor forms the central processing unit of your system. We will see the detailed architecture and internal circuitry of microprocessor in our subsequent classes. Next important thing is memory. So as you can see over here, RAM and ROM forms your memory unit in your microcomputer system. I hope all of you all know the functioning of the unit. What is RAM and what is ROM? Memory, it basically stores the information, okay? Like your instruction, your data, and it stores this instruction and data in the form of bits, okay? And then whenever microprocessor requires this information, microprocessor fetches this information from the memory. And who fetches this information from the memory? It is your instruction register. And this data is given to the instruction register using this parallel line, which is your bus, that is your peripheral line to your central processing unit. Now, as you all can see, the memory, it is divided into two units, which is RAM, that is random access memory, and ROM, which is read-only memory. So read-only memory, it is used to store the programs which does not require any kind of modifications or alteration. Okay, like your hard-coded OS programs and so on. RAM, on the other hand, it is a user memory. So since it is a user memory, it is a temporary memory which is used to store programs and data, which can be read, and also you can alter this data which is present in your random access memory. Okay, so these two units, which is RAM and ROM, forms your entire memory unit, and it is connected to your system bus. As you can see, RAM has bidirectional phase, that is bidirectional interface with the system bus. That means you can write the data and also you can read the data. There is modification allowed. But in ROM, there is only one unidirectional phase towards the system bus. That means you can only read from random only memory. You cannot write into it. That means you cannot alter that particular memory. Okay. Next unit is your input-output devices. So input and output devices are very important and primary features of your microcomputer system. Input devices gives input to the system, that is the data which is required to perform the calculation, and output, it is used to display and give the user the output of the calculation in some direct or indirect manner. Now these input and output devices, they are mainly called as peripheral devices. What are the different input devices? Your keyboard, your switches, converters, microphones, etc. And output devices are LEDs, printers, DA converters, and so on. So this forms your input-output devices. As you can see, since input device gives you the data, there is a unidirectional phase which goes from input device to the system bus. And since you provide, that means the microprocessor provides output to the output devices here, again, we have a unidirectional phase which goes from system bus to the output devices. So this is how our overall microcomputer system looks like. There is a microprocessor, there is a memory unit, and there is an I/O unit. And all these three units, they interact with each other using something known as system bus. Now, this system bus, though it feels like a single bus, it is divided into various categories, that is address bus, data bus, control bus, tri-state bus, and so on. And we will see each bus is the type of buses in detail, its functionality in our subsequent classes. So students, that is it for today's lecture. We have seen the block overview of your microprocessor, advantages of microprocessor, the classifications, categories of microprocessor, and lastly, the place of microprocessor in your microcomputer architecture. Okay, if you have any difficulties, you can ask me now, or you can drop me a query on my email ID. Thank you.